Alright guys, let's turn the car around and do the rears. Remember, the rears for now are only pads, so it's going to be much quicker. And the reason, a lot of people ask, maybe you don't read every single thing I write. Why didn't you get rear rotors? Because DBA doesn't make them yet. And I had some incorrect information in a previous video. It is not the 14 to 15 Forester crossover where the pads are a problem. It is anything 14 and up where the Forester added EyeSight. Even though a lot of sites will advertise like 2008 Forester Plus everything for the rear rotor, it does not fit when you get to 14, for DBA at least. And if you go on DBA's own application guide themselves, they have a blank spot for 2014 Forester rears availability. They don't exist yet. When they exist, I'll go ahead and get those in later. But for now, I'm gonna make do. I do not anticipate any balance problems doing it this way without the rotors. The pads will all be equal, and the front does most of the work anyway. Let's get the Forester switched around, backed in, and I'll take care of the rear, and we'll be done. All right, I'll show you a couple things on the rear. Just where I'm jacking it up is going to be right under the metal piece there. Now, not this hanging down piece, because that is plastic, but behind it, you got solid metal right where that block is going to touch. Yes, I do have jack stand pads coming. I've been meaning to buy those for years. Too late today, but if you go down real gentle, you'd probably be okay, but ideally, you want the little pads that go over these, which I have on the way for the future, just to protect the pinch a little bit. It's not really meant to sit on a jack stand, but the weight can usually handle it. All right, guys, for the rear, same deal basically, but a lot less work to do. Crack your calipers off. And let me get gloves. The one mistake you'll make is use gloves for 80% of the job, then get lazy toward the end, and you've wasted the whole reason you wore gloves in the first place, and your hands are messed up. Be right back. All right, I got the caliper off and hanging. Pull out the pads. Again, the pads are barely used. Get the light. Barely used, really. I don't think they're even half used at 20, whatever I said, 25, 26,000 miles. Wiggle those pads out. Come on, you bitch. Okay. We get a tool. This one's a little snug. Boom, right there. And keep them side to side again. Your anti-squeal clip is on the insides of these, meaning it's at the bottom. You don't want to put it here at the top. It'll judder. You want it at the bottom. Anyway, you can also tell by the markings, as we mentioned before. All right, I am actually going to clean this crap a little bit. I'm going to clean this crap off, and then we'll go ahead and put in the new pads. I can't, in my right mind, put in new pads with hardware kits that look like this. All right, that's a little better. Got it a lot cleaner, so let me do the other one. And then we're pretty good to have a decent, clean install and not a junky, super scummy hardware kit. All right, we have the SP500 DBA pads in the rear. Perfect fit, as you would expect. And we're ready to put the caliper back on. Push in the piston first, put the caliper on, torque and tighten and torque the caliper bolts, then do a mini bleed on the caliper just for the hell of it, then we're done. Much easier than the fronts. All right, guys, let's check the rears for any bleeding real quick. Pump them and hold them. Couple bubbles. Okay, again. Couple small ones again. All right, that side's done. Wouldn't you know, the only side of bleeding I decide not to film is where I get the most air. I got 4 or 5 nice-sized bubbles out of the last rear that I just didn't film, and now, of course, I wish I had. All right, so there might have been some air in that system, too. It's been in there a long time. So we're all bled. I'm going to take it out and bed it. I'm not going to record that. It's a boring video. I'm just going to slowly warm up the brakes and then do a few hard stops and come back, and then they're ready. They won't be gripping it. They won't feel good at all until you bed them. They're going to feel like, well, they're not even grabbing. How weak? Was this a total waste of money? You have to get them hot. Remember, I did a whole discussion on the bedding and friction, and sandpaper on a metal sheet will have a little friction. Sandpaper on sandpaper will have double the friction. That's why you're wiping off pad. You're getting it hot. You're melting it, basically, onto the rotor. It's sort of like having sandpaper on both sides. It'll grip better than sandpaper only on one side. Brake pads. Brake pad on both sides of the surface will grip better than brake pad only on one side of the surface. So that's about it. Hopefully it performs well. I'm going to go out and have some fun. Back from the bedding. Those brakes are killer. Insane. Exactly the same as the WRX after the bedding, where you just feather the pedal a bit, like an inch or two, and it just pulls you to a stop so strongly and such a strong bite. They're excellent. Let's see how the bedding went. I remember they were really shiny and smooth before, and you can see all the horizontal lines. That's the melted pad, as we talked about, you know, theoretically. That's putting pad on the rotor, and that's why it now grips so hard. And if your rotors were still shiny and you didn't bed them, you're only getting half of your braking. I can smell a tiny bit of brake, which I hope, because I did a bunch of 60, 70s to 5 mph stops as hard as I could. Never activated the ABS, never could get anything strange to happen. It just, you know, got better and better as I broke the brakes in. And then, of course, you want to let it cool fully between each one, cool a little, then cool fully before you test and see how it all went, because you want your everything to be back to normal and dry, so to speak, and then you test your grip. If you test it while the pad material is still a little bit, you know, hot and moist, it's not going to grip as good as when it dries, hardens, and you hope that you're not really going to get the brakes that hot under any normal driving. You're purposely overheating them in a way. So then once it gets to a normal temperature, then it grips even better than when it's still warm from the bedding, where it's not quite solid yet, you know? So that looks really, really good. I did decide one thing. I definitely am going to get steel brake lines for this car too. It makes too much of a difference. The WRX brakes are so perfect. The only thing missing here for the feel is the stainless steel brake lines. I wasn't going to do them, but I'm going to do them. Unfortunately, they're about $200. I'll talk to K&S. You can probably get me some kind of deal on them. But the number one time where you will notice stainless steel lines, you're sitting at a stop. You keep your foot on the brake. You use some strength. Your foot keeps sinking. That's your rubber lines expanding. It isn't the brakes slipping, it isn't air. You're actually physically expanding the rubber lines. When you get stainless lines in there, you push it to a stop, it's a rock. It does not continue sinking the harder you push. It's a rock, it doesn't move. That is the best telltale sign of how good stainless steel lines are and how they work. That concludes probably part two, probably be a two-part video. These brakes are awesome. I love them, of course. Thanks a lot to K&S Brakes for giving me a deal on those. And these should last a long time. I can't wait to tell the wife to go test the car. Also, I got the, well, I'll make a separate video on the cop.